Now, in this segment, we're going to look at an overview of a model to approach media literacy. We're going to look at media literacy as a particular expression of literacy generally, and as something that deserves deep thought whenever you're producing something, whenever you're designing something, whenever you're critiquing something, or whether you're using something with your family or your class, something where you can be either a media critic or a media producer. Media literacy embraces at least both of those things, where you're a critical consumer of media, but you're also a critical, thoughtful developer and designer of media. So we want to think about media literacy in both of those directions, and I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because the actual concepts I'll share are generic today. There are many specific models and specific approaches that you can find for any particular medium you're looking at. If somebody wants to look at some aspect of social media, they'll have a particular way and set of tools that you can use for that. But I want to look at generally, what are some things that we consider in media literacy, and I'm going to use something called the TRAP model. It's actually adapted from a model out of the UK, and it's I think particularly useful in as an overview of thinking how can we go about this. Now, why a quick overview instead of an in-depth survey? If this is such an important topic, why wouldn't we just really dig in and let me spend 6 hours messing around with the ideas? Well, I think they're accessible ideas to begin with. I think that your own skill levels and your own experience will come into play and make it pretty quick business of dealing with ideas of media literacy. But more importantly, I think that it's one thing to know about it. It's a whole another thing to do it. And where you'll really learn and develop your sophistication with media literacy, I think, is in the act of doing it. So I would challenge you to take anything that we talk about here and anything you pick up in other places about media literacy and go about the business of applying them. When next time you're at a theater watching a commercial film, apply these ideas. Think about them. Think that product through, considering each of the elements we'll talk about today. When you go online and you experience some social media exchange, think through the different elements we'll talk about and see whether they apply. Do they inform the kinds of things you're encountering? And I think you'll find that in almost every case they do, and your own sophistication will develop. And as you use the model, not as you learn about it, but as you actually push it into action, it'll also disrupt the way you look at media. As a media critic and as a media developer, you are going to develop a set of skills and a particular predisposition to looking at things that will disrupt your just regular passive enjoyment and experience of media. Every time you look at something, if you become a media critic, it'll be subject to criticism and your jaundiced eye that you placed on it, that you place on it. I think that's a good thing, but do believe me in that it can be a little disruptive. You can annoy your families with it by watching the latest release of a television series, say, and then you sit back and you're picking it apart using a media literacy or critical media literacy approach. Don't be surprised if a member of your family doesn't say, "Shut up, let me watch." Anyhow, let's have a look at this. We're going to use the TRAP model from, like I say, it's an adaptation from the UK. The rationale for media literacy, first of all, why literacy? Well, it is. Language development is, we know it's essential to education. And media, and especially social media now, are even more pervasive in society than conventional print. So if literacy and language development in conventional ways is important, then shouldn't mediated consideration just as important? I argue that it is. I think it's just as important, perhaps even more important at certain stages of life. And this is coming from an ex-English teacher. So I cherish books and I cherish conventional text, but I do think that mediated text has other kinds of media representations of text are just as important. Okay, and I think students need to understand media. Their representations, their underlying texts, the audiences that make meaning from them, and how they're produced and distributed, their own participation in what becomes a culture of participation in media. All of those things, skills, knowledge, attitudes that are appropriate to things, all of that, I think, are critical. Media construct their own reality. We know that. When we create something and we mediate it, we put it on video, we've already constructed a reality. When you write something and you send it in, let's say, a letter to the editor somewhere or a comment on a web page, that constructs a reality. And we've seen that some people are particularly skilled at manipulating reality and how we experience things. Others, not particularly skilled. Some people, trolls on the internet and whatnot, just go in and just wail away at things and just try to disrupt. Knowing that is a power tool in your tool belt. All right, students need to read and employ media critically. We've seen so many cases from Amanda Todd on where very sad stories about how students have unhappy experiences, unhappy conclusions to their interaction in media, both social media and how students interact with conventional media, even film and video, that they see things, how critical are they as consumers? Are they skilled consumers? Do they know what they're looking at? Do they know how to situate that? Do they understand the difference between mediated events and reality? Can they discern the differences? Can they judge when something is real and when it's fake? All of those kinds of things. Critical skills in media literacy enhance meaning and understanding and enjoyment. People's own enjoyment of things and their own communication skills, their ability to use media more effectively. All of those things, I think, critically important. Now, the media concepts that we'll talk about very quickly, and your instructor will have other kinds of things for you with this that you can use, handouts and whatnot. But the TRAP model, text. When we look at media, media literacy, we're going to look at media as, and consider it as text, as representation, as audience, and who is the audience, and the production of it. And how do all, so if we're criticizing something, a product or an event that was produced by somebody else, we would look at it as text, as representation, who the audience it was intended for and what do we know about them, and the production values. And then what are the things that were involved in the production? Who owns it? Why did they put it together the way they did? Why does it look the way it does? Why is it sold and distributed the way it is? All of those kinds of things merging into a model of criticism. Also, if we make something, we can look at what we make as text. We can look at what we make as what we're representing. What is it we're really trying to get across? Well, how are we trying to represent things? Well, what about the audience? Who will the audience be for something? If we think that through carefully, we're more likely to be more effective in what we produce and its effects on people and whether or not that'll be, as successful as we would like. So we'll look at each of those things. Text. Everything is text, right? Everything is text. every media is text. When you go to a concert and you're seeing a performer on a stage, that's text. Okay? Everything they do, every dance move they make, every lyric they offer, every pause and interaction with the audience is text and available to you for criticism. Okay? So, but things like cinema, media products like cinema, social media, music, news, all those kinds of things are text. And we use that kind of language. In media literacy, we use the language of, well, what was the text of this? And when we say that, it could be a video, could be text. Okay? But popular culture can also be text. Clothing, computer games, political campaigns can be text. They carry the substance that we intend to criticize. Sporting events are text, concerts as text, as I mentioned before. It includes the consideration when you're thinking of text, you're thinking of the medium itself. What medium is being used? What medium is between me and the entity that's communicating with me? What is that medium and how does it affect things? What is the genre? Are we looking at a horror film? Are we looking at a jazz music present, a jazz concert? Are we looking at opera? Are we looking at poetry? Are we looking at a political speech, stump speech somewhere? All of those things have to do with genre and certain expectations obtain when you know what the genre is, and you kind of know it's going to fit this way, it's going to do those kind of things. And if it violates those expectations, it makes it that much more interesting for us as media critics. There are coded meanings. Now, we've spoken of semiotic theory and how things are coded. Things are put into signs, are built into code structures that we then employ. So, coded meanings, let's say how a video sequence of shots in video portray certain kinds of meanings, whether or not we're using flashbacks or flash forwards, all of those kinds of things. Whether the narrative that's being given, beautiful examples of this in documentary film, where narrative takes on the role of carrying the viewer through a visual representation of something. I love how skilled narrative can be written in a way that is fluid and beautiful, elegant, graceful. We see excellent examples of narrative in all kinds of I think documentary form of things, but the narrative is also think of your favorite politician who speaks intimately to you. Okay, when you hear a stump speech by that politician, they really speak to your soul. Listen to how the narrative is constructed on those things. If you are looking at a commercial film, think about how the story is carried through narrative. Let's say that the narrative may not even be the spoken word in this case. It could be a visual narrative that's employed. And look at how the story is carried, how it's strung together, how it's brought to some kind of a climax, some kind of denouement. And that happens in almost everyone. Think about the text as commodity, something that is a preservable, substantive thing, and in some cases, that is sold. It's available for sale. Okay? Something that is a product. And think about connections. How is this text, whatever it is, if it's a saying on a t-shirt, how is it connected to other things? And making those connections. Okay, so text, probably one of the most important things that we do in media criticism and media literacy is consider text. The R, TRAP, representation. Now, we know that everything is a portrayal of everything that we consider in media literacy is a portrayal of the world through media. We know it's mediated. Okay, so there is a thing in there doing something to it. Whether that thing is a microphone or it's a video camera, if it's a GoPro camera stuck on somebody's helmet and they jump off of a building, everything is mediated. Okay, you don't experience the real thing, you experience it secondhand. It includes the way people and events are represented. The word represented means re-presented. We just break down that word, and it means it's presented again. So it's presented again and in a different way. And so we have to appreciate, and our students have to appreciate, my goodness, the times, the depth of ignorance that I fear the most is when people look at mediated events and they take them as literal reality. Okay? If we can get our students just to understand that media products are constructions, every one of them, okay? As much as they even try, even if there's an honest, authentic attempt to make something as real as possible, it's still a construction. And we see reality TV, you know, somebody's out in the bush somewhere and they're hunting deer, or they're stuck on a snowmobile out somewhere in the bush. Well, there's a camera crew with them. They aren't in as much trouble as they look like they're in most of those cases, all right? So things are constructions. If we can just get our students to appreciate that there's somebody on the other side of that camera, okay? We will have gone strides in media literacy. Products are the result of various forces and determinants. There are political reasons things are the way they are. There are cultural forces at work whenever we see a media construction. When it's represented a particular way, it means that something has acted culturally, socially, to encourage it or force the thing to look and project certain kinds of messages in certain ways. When we see this in bold relief, don't we? In bas relief, when we have political campaigns going on, different parties are presenting the same issues in completely different ways. And they're under tremendous pressure to do that from their constituents and their parties to present things in particular ways. And when they deviate from that, and when they do unexpected things, is when the media really love to, the news media love to get involved. That makes it more interesting because we have expected forces and we have the little surprise corners where people go. But representation includes, at the very least, a consideration of construction, how things are put together, realism, and where the lines of real and false are drawn, stereotypes, and kinds of things like that that are inherently embedded in the documents and in the products, and then ideology and the values alternatives that are available to people. All right, so whenever you're thinking about the next time you're at a theater and you're watching a film, think about those things. Think about its construction, its realism, its stereotypes, and the ideology and the values alternatives that were available. The next time you see the news coverage of a major event, let's say take a terrible event like a shooting in a nightclub somewhere. Think about the construction. Think about the realism involved. Where is it real and where is it constructed? How has it been mediated? Are there stereotypes involved of either the shooters or the victims? Think about the ideology and the values alternatives that are available to people when they present, when the news media cover and present that information. And I think it'll give you a fresh way to look at some things. At least I hope so. The audience, now TRAA, audience. We should always be thinking about those who consume media products, whether they're our products or whether we're the audience that's consuming the media product in front of us. How do we fit into a group? When we go to a particular film, okay, are we making a statement about we're the kinds of people who attend romantic comedies or action films, or we love horror films? So, you know, do we fit into a set of stereotypes around and characteristics of audiences who attend to particular mediated events in particular way and consume products in particular ways? If we're creating something, do we know who we're aiming at? Do we know who that audience is? If we create something for everybody, very likely we're producing it for ourselves, because everybody won't get involved, and so we're probably producing it for people like us, whatever that is. Okay, what do we know about those people? How do they understand and use messages? How will they employ the product that maybe we're experiencing, or when we produce, how will they then use those messages? How are people affected by media? How are they helped by it, informed by it, hurt by it, insulted by it, elevated by it? All of those kinds of things. What do we know about that when we consider the audiences? It includes a consideration of culture, skills, uses, effects, you know, all of those things involved. Does an audience have the skill necessary to even understand what you're trying to say? Do they have the skill to consume whatever product that you're creating? Do they understand the effects of what you're creating, or the effects of what it is that's being offered to them? All of these things, tremendously important. And then production. Now, we in media are consumed with production. We love production. We have production companies. We have production opportunities. We go rent equipment and we create things. We download software online that'll allow us the newest kind of subtle change that we can make to things that we produce. We love making stuff. So we're consumed with understanding how that stuff then is made. Well, in the TRAP model of media literacy, we can think about the making and marketing of media texts. Now, texts, again, being all kinds of things. But think about who's making them and how are they marketing those? Why are they being made and marketed the way they are? Who are the agencies and individuals who create and control the media we consume? Who are we joining when we create things and impose that on other people? What technologies are available and what practices those production companies use when we're consuming or experiencing media? Thinking about those practices that they use. How many are enduring, like certain kinds of shot sequences, and how many are temporary, like the current status of CGI, okay? Computer graphics are changing like crazy, of course. And so the greater and greater sophistication and realism that are available to us now is compared to media that were created only 5-10 years ago. If you look at those media products, you can spot it in a second, that they're older. Right? And they're using outdated technologies and practices. Do your students have the sophistication to see that and understand what they're looking at? And that's an area of constant growth and change. The economic and political forces that are at work with any media products. This is important. I mean, when you think about the enormous amounts of money that are involved in the production of something like as simple as a television ad or an ad that appears on the internet. Hundreds of thousands of dollars easily, and sometimes millions of dollars, can go into the production of a highly sophisticated ad campaign. Well, they aren't fooling around when they do that. There are strong forces at work. When you have a marketing campaign that's funded at a very high level, the expectation levels are very high that it's be sophisticated, persuasive, and that it works and it shows returns. Now, thinking about those economic and cultural and political imperatives is an important part of reconsidering any media we look at. You can look at certain marketing campaigns and you'll see that you'll understand that the probably right off the bat that there are certain entire documentary productions that have a smaller budget than a 30-second commercial. Now, how did that play into what you're looking at? What were those production values? Sometimes those production values are actually used. People will use low production value and invest very little in them financially, so that it gives a sense of more intimacy and immediacy and reality. Those are actually very cheap to make, and they give that they close the perceptual distance between the viewer and the producer in some cases. All right. So it includes the consideration of the institution that's involved in the production. Is it MGM? Or is it the University of Saskatchewan? Or is it a program? Or is it an individual? Or is it a self-help group putting something out? Thinking about the institution behind something, the technology, the industry itself and how it operates, knowing more and more about that and the practices involved in all of those. These kinds of things are important aspects of media literacy, understanding how media are created, presented, and consumed. As you go through experiencing all kinds of media, I hope you'll just reflect on some of those just so simple ideas and think about how they inform what you create and what you experience.